A window. Ah, there you go. I think you can see it now, Nick, right?
Not yet.
Wait, just a minute. Okay, and then I will share it.
Yes.
Is it there now, Nick?
I think it's working.
Okay.
It's already open.
Yes, okay. Yeah, I hope everyone can see from where you are coming from. And then perhaps I need to maximize this for everybody. Am I right?
I think you need to
maximize, Nick.
Yes, from the one at the bottom part.
Yes. It says sharing. Yes. No, I should not stop sharing. No. Yeah. But you can see it now.
Yes, ma'am. But I think you need to maximize it.
Okay, I'll just maximize now. Okay, then just please tell me if
you can actually click at 5.
Maximize, Nick, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, okay, I'll do that now, huh? Okay, maximize. Okay, is that all right, Nick?
Not yet.
Hey, not yet, Nick.
Okay, but it's okay.
Okay.
No worries, you can go.
This one, how about this one, Nick? Is it fine now? Maximize? No. I think so, no?
Lower right portion, ma'am.
Okay, lower right.
Yung ano, it's not like a trophy na yeah. Icon.
Uh-huh, top, and then?
I-click yan, yung the one that looks like a trophy icon.
Turn on captions or something? Sorry.
Near, like you have there the comments, right?
Just a minute, huh? Let me see. Comments. Oh dear. What it says here is you are presenting and then turn on.
At the bottom part of your PowerPoint.
Okay, at the bottom. It says sharing a window.
You have your notes, comments.
Ala, I don't have that. Just a minute, huh? Wait, no, I don't have
that. Go on with that PowerPoint, the same as last time.
Yes.
Okay.
But can you see it already from where you are? Okay. You can see it na, Nick, no?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
I don't need to maximize anymore.
Okay.
Yeah. So I hope everyone is on board now, huh? Sorry for the technical difficulty that I am actually experiencing, but nevertheless, this is our session on discourse for English language teachers. Yes, if most of you, or if not all of you, were with us the other week, we actually talked about grammar for English language teachers. And I'd like to draw a line between grammar and discourse, because actually when we talk about discourse, it pertains to both oral as well as written communication. However, for purposes of learning one skill, for every session, we focused the other week on grammar in terms of written communication. So for tonight's session on discourse, let's focus on oral communication. Now, I'd like to make a rejoinder once again to what we had discussed last time, no? Because I'd like to emphasize that even if you are teaching English or the English language to speakers of other languages or those whose medium of communication is not English and whose native tongue is not English, let us also not lose our identity as English language teachers. In other words, if you are teaching, like for example, a nursery class and you're teaching them English, I don't think we can be at par with our students, because you are the teacher. That means that you also have to be a notch higher than your students or your pupils. So our objective, same with our objective of last time, our objective for our session today is that let us improve ourselves as English language teachers so that we can better communicate to our learners and make them feel that English is something that we do normally. English is a language that we speak. I have to say, like natives, even if we are not native speakers, but let's try our very best to imbibe this particular skill in terms of making our learners and our students feel that the English language is something that they can do practically every day, and that this is a language that they can communicate with people from all over the world. So thus, I hope we are set with that particular thing in mind, because this is now going to be discourse or oral communication for English language teachers. Now, very importantly, how do we develop good communication skills? Again, may I zero in on oral communication. It is important for us to have good communication skills, because this can help us do our presentations in class, because after all, this is going to be our medium of instruction. We should also be able to adeptly use the English language if we apply for a job. And I think some of you, if not most of you, are also planning to apply for jobs later on, or perhaps are in the process of applying for a job. It is also important to learn the English language and speak it well, no? Especially when we handle arguments or perhaps some disagreements, because this is one way by which we can relay our ideas as well as our insights and our thoughts clearly to our audience or to the person whom we are talking to, as well as in a variety of other situations. If there is a need for us to use the English language, for example, if you meet somebody who is not a native speaker of the English language, but who you have met maybe socially, and this person asked you for directions. No, this is very important. He or she will ask you, where is the nearest pharmacy or the nearest drugstore here? You should be able to give the directions or the instructions very clearly if you use the English language. Thus, it's important for you to learn this skill in oral communication. Of course, there are also some skills that other speakers of English who are native speakers can also use, which we can probably learn from as we go along. So I think I have some examples here later on as we move on with our discussion tonight. Now, let's understand the basics of communication skills, because after all, there will probably be other sessions on discourse or on grammar, but let's try to understand the basics of skills in communication. And what are these? Let us first and foremost know what communication really is. Communication is actually a two-way thing or a two-way situation. Communication is never one way. That means that when we are communicating to our students, to our learners, to our pupils, or even to parents and even our fellow workers, it has to be a two-way type of communication. It should never be one way, or perhaps something that is done unilaterally. It's always two-way. So it's between two individuals or two persons or even more. However, when we talk about communication, there are actually so many platforms or situations. There are nonverbal cues, there is nonverbal communication, there are gestures that we also use, there are actions, and even our facial expressions may change depending on what our communication is or what our message is. So I think I have some examples here that we can discuss, or perhaps you can mull over as we also move on in this particular discussion tonight. So know what communication really is and how it can change our lives as teachers and as learners, of course. Second is, let us always be courageous to say what we think. No? I know you are in a foreign setting, but we have learners from across the globe. We have learners from all over the globe. And in certain countries or in certain places, there may be some cultural differences that you are experiencing with your peers or with your colleagues. But let's always be courageous to say what we think. But let's also remember to say it courteously, to say it politely, to say it pleasantly. So even if we may be outspoken, or even if we are vocal with our ideas, even if we may disagree with one another, let's still be polite and courteous. And this is where the choice of your words will come in, as well as the tone of your voice, because this is pertaining to discourse. That's very important, huh? The tone of your voice, the pitch of your voice, the choice of your words is also very important. Even if you are speaking to very young learners, or even to learners who have actually been around for quite some time, we have to know where they are coming from. So be courageous with to say what you think, but at the same time, be polite and be courteous as well. And yes, there is the word confidence. If you know what you're talking about, I don't think you cannot be confident. Thus, if you know your the language, you know your lessons, you know the pedagogy that you are supposed to use, you know your strategies, your methods, as well as your approaches in teaching, then you can confidently say that you have something to relay to your learners. And that's really very important for us teachers to do that. What else are we supposed to remember, especially when we are doing discourse as English teachers? Let us practice. I think one participant asked me that question the other week when we were talking about grammar for English language teachers. And that participant said, how can I improve my oral skills in communication? Especially that participant came from another field, no? I think that participant came from corporate communication, and that's an entirely different field when you go into teaching. But how do I harness or enrich my skills in communication? I think my answer was practice, no? So when you practice your skills, I think you will be able to develop it, not really overnight, but through months and through years of practice. Before you know it, you can be a confident speaker because you have constantly practiced. Can you practice inside your classroom? Because I think many of you, or if not most of you, are teachers. Can you practice inside your classroom? I would say yes, but it would also be best if you can practice in front of the mirror, if you can practice before some friends of yours or some family members who can give you feedback about how you did, or what you did, or how you were able to cope with what it is that you are trying to relay to your audience. So practice, not necessarily immediately when you get into your classes or before your students, but you can practice on your own, practice before the mirror, or perhaps you can request some friends of yours to listen to you so that they can give you constructive criticism or constructive feedback. And that's really very important. But practice, and of course, preparation. That's really something that we should bear in mind. And then, yes, in discourse, we really have to engage our audience. What does that mean? Engaging our audience means that we have to connect with our audience. It's different when we are engaged in written communication. In written communication, feedback is very limited. Of course, it's obvious, no? Because we are into written communication. When I write something, or when I communicate something through written communication, feedback may come in much later. But when we pertain to discourse, or when we talk about discourse or oral communication, the feedback is immediate. Thus, we are able to engage our audience right away in discourse or in oral communication. And that's really extremely primordial in our job as teachers. Let's engage our audience. Let's connect to our audience. Thus, the question now is, how do we do that? No? How do we engage our audience, especially if your learners come from varied sectors, varied backgrounds, and in fact, from varied or different age brackets? So let's try to do this. First and foremost, any speaker should be able to establish eye contact. That's really very important. However, with the situation that we are all in now, here we are, no? This is a virtual class. Thus, perhaps you may say, how do I engage my audience in a virtual class such as this? I'm doing it now. I'm trying to engage with you, but of course, our resources are limited. Here I am, I may be trying to establish eye contact with you, but all I see right now on my screen are letters, and I think these letters pertain to your first names or perhaps your surnames. There are a couple of photos that I am looking at here, but these are not warm bodies. These are not people who I see while I am speaking. So I am practically talking to my screen, to my laptop screen, and that's really difficult. But I'm trying to establish eye contact with you. I'm now looking at my camera, and I hope you can see me and hope that you can discern that I'm trying to establish eye contact with you. But if in the near future, and we're hoping this will soon end, no, and that we can have face-to-face contact with our audience or person-to-person contact with our students and learners, it's really very easy to establish eye contact. You just have to look at them straight in the eye, and that's now eye contact. Now, you can also determine the sincerity of a person if he or she looks at you straight in the eye. Have you tried to converse with some friends? If the conversation moves on maybe for more than 15 or 20 minutes, and if that person doesn't look at you straight in the eye, there must be something wrong. Perhaps the person is not really sincere with what he or she is telling you. So establish eye contact. Make sure that you are connected to your audience that way. And that's really how it should be, no? As teachers. And then how else? How else can we make sure that we are effective teachers, especially when we're talking about discourse? Let me see. I'm sorry. I think I jumped to the next slide. Just a minute, no? Okay. Okay, here we are. Yes. So after making sure that we have established eye contact, can you imagine a speaker or perhaps all of us who are in the teaching profession not to be using actions or gestures, especially when we are speaking? We definitely have to use gestures. It could be your hands. It could be your hands. It could be perhaps the way you speak to them. Perhaps it could also pertain, or gestures could also pertain to your facial expression. Maybe you can make some changes in the way you appear to your audience or to your learners. Anything that would make you be able to connect to them or engage with them. And that is through the use of actions or gestures. I cannot imagine a speaker who is trying to engage his or her audience and who stands like a statue in front of the audience. I don't think your learners would like to see you that way. No? So you use gestures. You can also pace, no? Or walk to and fro, but not very often, of course, otherwise your learners will get dizzy. You can walk or pace to and fro from one end of your classroom to the next, and then maybe you can stop a bit so that your learners also will not get dizzy, and so that they can focus on you as you try to relay your message to them. But very importantly, use gestures. And there are so many ways by which you can emphasize your lessons or your message through gestures that you are using. It could either be through your hands or, as I mentioned, through your facial expression. Okay, third. Now, there is what we call as mixed messages, no, or mixed signals. For example, if your class is quite unruly and there are pupils who are quite noisy or who are talking all at the same time, what do you do? Maybe you will raise your voice, no? That's really very normal. Maybe you will raise your voice, change the tone or the pitch of your voice. Of course, I think our facial expression will change if we are trying to reprimand our pupils, but I don't think we should be smiling, no? Because that would send mixed signals to our learners. So in other words, if you are quite angry, but not really very angry, because perhaps your students are really very young, or even if your students may be in a particular age bracket where they can understand you and where they know that you that they should be polite or courteous, even if they may be in a particular age bracket, do not send mixed signals or mixed messages. So in other words, if you're trying to discipline them, your facial expression should also look stern. You do not smile. But if you try to acknowledge a good behavior, then of course you say, you tell them that they did very well. And then yes, of course you smile. No? I think that's a culture that not only Filipinos have adapted, but I think it's something that the human nature really practices, or human beings really practice. When they are happy, they smile or they laugh. When they are upset, maybe their facial expressions change. Maybe they have a scowl on their face. Or when they are disappointed, maybe they also exhibit another facial expression. So these are normal reactions that we do, no? But let us make sure that our actions or our gestures, including our facial expressions, also reflect the message that we are trying to impart. Huh? Okay, let's move on. Huh? Be aware of what your body is saying. There is a phrase that says, I think we're all familiar with this, we say body language. But since we're talking about this in the context of the English language, I'd like to call it as body English, body language. But since we are English language teachers, I'd like to revise it a bit and say, or modify it a bit and say body English. And this pertains to nonverbal communication. Nonverbal communication, meaning our actions, our gestures, our facial expressions. And I wish I could stand up and demonstrate it to you, or perhaps if we have a face-to-face interaction, I can do it before you, or like make some actions, because it's quite difficult here, no? But for example, if I cross my arms, no? If I cross my arms in front of me or in front of my body, what signal am I trying to get across my audience? It may mean that I am quite strict. I do not accept any excuses. I do not accept any explanations, because I am a closed-minded individual. Perhaps, no, maybe that could be how they would interpret it. If my arms are closed, no, it's closed and they are near my body. That means that I am not quite open to their ideas, and I am a closed-minded individual. But if I extend, or if I open my arms wider and have a smile on my face, then maybe my learners would say, oh, our teacher is accepting us as individuals. Our teacher is listening to us. And that would come out really very favorably to our learners. So be aware, huh, of what our body is saying. Sometimes we may not really be aware that we may not be conscious that our facial expressions have changed already. So let's try to minimize, if ever, no? For example, if we're not feeling really well, or if not we're not feeling quite well, of course our facial expressions change. But always remember that we are in front of our class. We are talking to people. They are looking at us, because we are the center of attention. We are the teacher, or we are the messenger, if I'd like to call ourselves as such. Thus, let's be careful of what our body is actually saying through our actions, through our gestures, through our facial expressions. And even, I'd like to put this in, no? Or include this here, even in the way we dress, or even in our physical appearance. As teachers, I think in Vietnam, for example, I think you may have uniforms. In Siliman University in Dumaguete City, Philippines, where I teach and where Sir Nico was a student of mine as well, we do not have a uniform for our tertiary level. But teachers who are in the School of Basic Education, elementary, junior high school, at least until junior high school, they wear uniforms, no? So let's also be conscious of our physical appearance. Let's be conscious of the way we dress, because it's also one way by which we communicate, even if it is non-verbally. So if you give credence, or if you give importance to your learners, that means that you have to dress appropriately. You have to dress well because you are you are a teacher and you are setting a good example. So that's what we mean by body English. I'd like to say body English instead of body language. Then as teachers, as always, we give feedback to our students, no? But there is a way by which we can communicate this in such a manner that we are also sensitive to the feelings of others. Remember, friends, ladies and gentlemen, and colleagues in the teaching profession, our learners are highly sensitive individuals, much more so today that we are amid a pandemic. Even if our learners may appear well, even if they may appear fine, even if they may be in our classes every day and we meet with them, little do we know about what goes on in their mind. So if we are not sensitive to their feelings, and if we blurt out words that may not exactly be pleasant to them, or even the pitch or the tone of our voice, because this is already discourse, it will mean a great deal to them. So let's be conscious of the feelings of other people, and let's be sensitive. And if ever we have some feedback that we need to tell our learners or our friends or our colleagues, for example, let's make sure that these are all constructive feedback, so that our relationship with them would not change or would not be affected at all. Okay, then yes, I'd like to say, and I'd like to believe that in communication, even if we say that it's a two-way type of communication, communication is not all speaking, no? Again, may I say this? Communication is not all speaking, even if we say that communication is two-way. Why? There is also the listening skill that many among us may not exactly have harnessed. No? We may be good speakers, but are we good listeners? No? We may be good speakers, but are we also good listeners? Let's try to go back to that particular slide. No? Let's develop effective listening skills. May I ask you this question, which you don't need to answer right away? Can you listen to your friend, for example, or to your colleague talk about his or her woes or her problems in a matter of talking to him in 1 hour? Just that friend of yours talking, no, about his woes, about his problems, about his angst, his anxieties. You've been talking for 1 hour and he has been dominating the conversation. If you're a good listener, you will listen to that friend of yours in its entirety, in the entire 1 hour. Can I say that you have already developed your effective or good listening skills? Not yet, no? Because perhaps you were not saying anything. You were simply just hearing what your friend was saying. But were you listening to your friend? Perhaps you were merely hearing. What do we mean by hearing? You were simply just accepting the sound waves coming from his voice. But did you truly comprehend or imbibe what your friend was telling you? If you were able to do that in that span of 1 hour while he was speaking, then that means that you have already listened to your friend, because you had listened with comprehension. Now, I can empathize with our guidance counselors, because our guidance counselors are really trained to become good and effective listeners. The reason is, our guidance counselors, I'm talking about at least our experience at Silliman University, our guidance counselors are trained to be very good listeners, because their clientele or their clients exactly need an ear. And their clients exactly need someone to listen to them. So our guidance counselors just well, of course, they sit and listen, but they also give feedback. They also give some pieces of advice, and they try to encourage their client to, like, say, well, things will have to probably change for the better, but let's hang on. Let's hang on. Let's make sure that we are alive and well, that we are up and about, and that we're going about our normal humdrum of things. But let's make sure that our lives are becoming better, especially if we are in a midst, even if we are amid a challenging situation. But you have to develop your good listening skills. In other words, if you keep on interrupting, for example, a learner who is trying to give you a message, or perhaps sets a message across to you, and if you keep on interrupting, that means that you have not become a good or effective listener. So let's try to also develop our listening skills, and we can do that. But of course, with our session tonight, which is just for 1 hour, maybe we can have another session, maybe after later on, perhaps in future sessions, where we can have listening exercises as well, because this is very important. So, like right now, I wonder if you can deeply and consistently ask yourselves, have I been a good listener to my learners? No, but there are scientific exercises to prove whether indeed you have become a good listener. So let's try to develop that, aside, of course, from our skills in oral communication, because this is discourse. Now, let's go to using our words. The last time we met, no, that was about 2 weeks ago, we were talking about the use of written communication, and of course, using English. Use of written communication, thus using the proper or the appropriate words. And that's really something that we should also think about, because using the right words have to mean that we should be conscious about what to use appropriately in a particular situation. Let's talk about this in terms of discourse or oral communication. Whatever the words that you use, enunciate your words well. Okay, this is different from pronunciation, because pronunciation means that I can say the words clearly and correctly. That is pronunciation. But enunciation would mean that your learners, whoever they may be, should be able to distinguish the vowels from the consonants, the vowels from the diphthongs, the consonants from the diphthongs. Thus, for example, enunciating our words. No, for example, if you are teaching a group of young learners, maybe elementary school children, you're teaching them the sound of F, 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 F. Or let's use as an example, father. Father, they should be able to hear and discern the sound of F, 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 and the sound as well, no? Because this is father. It's not father or some other way of enunciating, but it should be father. So you're teaching them the sound of F, F, or F, fa, as well as TH, TH, or voiced consonants, father. So that's how you enunciate your words, no? So speak clearly and do not mince your words, or do not eat your words, as they say. But the correct term there would be mincing your words. And some people mumble. Now, why do you need to mumble? Mumbling would be tantamount to a garbled language, no? Or something like garbled audio, as how we call it now, because we are in a webinar, or we are in a virtual class. So make sure that your words are spoken clearly, not only proper pronunciation, but also proper enunciation. Okay, now this is the second one. No? We were talking about enunciation. I differentiated enunciation from pronunciation. So pronounce, no? Pronounce your words correctly, aside from enunciating it correctly. Now, there are certain individuals who may be able to pass, no? A pronunciation test with flying colors. For example, let us say if we have time, I can listen to each one of you pronounce certain words. I'm pretty certain most of you, if not all of you, because you are English language teachers, would be able to correctly pronounce such words correctly. Okay. However, if I will ask you to now, okay, because you have pronounced these words correctly, let us use these words in a sentence for each of the words that you're trying to pronounce correctly. Because you have passed it with flying colors, the next order of the day would be to use them correctly in a sentence. Thus, this is where the challenge is, no? If again, you'll have to tailor fit your examples to your learners. If your learners are really very young kids, very young individuals, then you have to tailor fit your example so that they will be able to understand you. Of course, if your learners are in a different age bracket and they may be advanced or intermediate, if that's how you call it, learners of the English language, then you'll also have to adjust. No? I think this is the beauty of the English language, because there is the simple way or simple words, then maybe you can graduate into the intermediate words, then you can graduate into the difficult words, more difficult words, and so on. So this is the challenge for all of us who are teaching English. We can tailor fit our examples to make sure that it is something that can be understood by the age bracket of our learners. So it's important for us to pronounce our words correctly, because our students and our learners will certainly follow us. No? Okay, now use the right words. I cannot think of a particular situation where a synonym may be used interchangeably with another word. Again, huh? I cannot imagine a situation where a synonym, what is a synonym? Of course, you know this, no? Synonym is a word that is similar in meaning with another word, but you're simply just using another word. I cannot imagine a synonym to also be used interchangeably in a particular situation, because even if they are synonyms, you have to use them appropriately in a particular situation. Thus, use the right words, no? Not words that you think are correct because they sound correct. Use the word that is correct. And let me see, maybe if I will think of some other examples as we go along, we may not have time for that, no? But I hope maybe through your questions later on, you can help me even, no, in the examples that we can use for this particular rule, using the right words. Okay. Now, some speech teachers would probably say, if you speak too slow, then you will lull your learners to sleep, or you may bore them. When do you slow down your speech? When do you increase your speech as well? Now, slowing down your speech would mean that you are sensitive to the needs of your learners, because they may not be able to understand you if you speak too fast. Remember, this is discourse, no? If you speak too fast, they will not be able to understand you, especially if you tend to mumble, which you should not, no? Or you tend to mince your words, again, which you should not be doing. So slow down your speech, but I think we can do this, no? Slowing down would not mean, or should not mean, that it's definitely going to put them to sleep, no? Thus, you can modify. There will probably certain times in your presentation or in your class where you can slow your speech down to emphasize a point. No? If you're going to emphasize a point, slow your speech down. But if you feel that if you can see that your learners are already getting unruly, they're falling asleep and so on, then you can increase the speed by which you speak so that they can be alert, they can be alive, then they can be awake as well. No? So be sensitive as well to the needs of your learners. And I think you are in the best position to do that, because you are in front of them, because you are their teacher. Okay, now develop our voice. My goodness. If I said that there are exercises on listening, there are also many exercises on developing our voice. In fact, if I may let you in on a secret, so it's not going to be a secret anymore because I'm telling you this, no? Like very recently, I tied up with some voice actors. Voice actors, no? I think you may have heard of voice acting as a profession. We have many of them in the Philippines because there is now a school or an institute for voice acting. In other words, these individuals who are trying to modify or revise their voices according to a particular situation, they try to develop this because this is a talent and you can even earn something out of it, maybe earn some money out of it. For example, if you are asked to voice a commercial, no, or an advertisement, and the role calls that your voice is that of an old woman, how are you going to change that? How are you going to change your voice? If you are a 20-year-old woman, how will you make your voice sound like, for example, an 80-year-old woman? In the same manner that if you may be a 35-year-old woman and the role calls for you to sound like a 3-year-old child, how are you going to do that? So, this is one particular industry today that is proliferating because of the emergence of virtual classes or online classes. So, voice acting, let's develop our voice, no? But generally speaking, if we are in the teaching profession, let us modulate our voices. That is the word, no? Let's modulate our voice, not too shrill, not too high-pitched, not too low either, no? If you are high-pitched, for example, if that is your natural voice, we cannot do anything about that, of course. But we can probably help you, or you can help yourself modulate your voice. How can we do that, no? Again, in front of the mirror, or perhaps in the privacy of your bedroom, you can practice, no? Developing your voice by speaking from the diaphragm, or speaking from your diaphragm. And that's really very effective. No, I have tried that several times. How do you do that? You cannot see me from where you are, but now I am trying to hold my diaphragm so that I can modulate my voice. No, if you hold your diaphragm, okay, and start to talk, parang there's a constricting position that you are doing, and it helps you modulate your voice. No, so speak from the diaphragm, not coming from your throat, okay, or not coming from elsewhere, not coming from your nose either, because you would sound like you're speaking with a twang, no? Not from your nose, because you would sound like you have a nasal voice. Most Americans, of course, no offense meant to Americans, usually they speak with a twang, they speak with a nasal voice, no, coming from their nose. But for us who are in the teaching profession, let's modulate our voice. A shrill or a high-pitched voice would probably mean that we are angry or that we are mad at our learners, no? If you are low-pitched, very low, perhaps your learners would say, oh, sir or ma'am may not exactly be feeling very well. So let's develop our voice. The key here would be to speak with a highly modulated voice. So that's how it should be, no? Then yes, my goodness, aside from developing our voice, this is really the challenge for us teachers, no? If you speak with a monotone, this will certainly bore your learners. For TESOL Coach Master, I was looking at some of their videos, and we had, or I saw some teachers really animatedly speaking to their learners. The learners were really very young, but wow, I have to take my hat off to the teacher because she was speaking animatedly. No, she was enjoying what she was doing. She spoke with much action. Her voice was also animated. No, She changed the pitch of her voice. She did not speak with a monotone. And the learners, no, the children, the pupils, the students were also very responsive because she changed her voice. I think the teacher was telling a story. And of course, if there are characters in the story, you really have to change, no, or animate your voice. Wow, that's really something. No? Now, again, may I go back to voice acting? There are websites of these voice actors, no? And I hope if I am able to share with you some of their links, especially if they are holding classes, then you can maybe pitch in and try to get some pointers from them. But animating our voice would really be helpful as teachers. And I'm doing that as well, even if we're merely just looking at our computers or staring at our screens and not exactly seeing our learners. No? This is very important. Yes, aside from making sure that our pace, no, the way we speak is not exactly too fast nor too slow, let us also apply appropriate volume. No? So speaking from the diaphragm, okay, that's modulating our voice. And at the same time, I hope most of us are gifted with a loud as well as booming voice. But if we are not, is that a problem? Not exactly, no, because of course you can amplify your voices. How do we do that? Well, if you may have microphones or anything that can amplify your voice, then you can use them. But what if there is no presence of a mic or a microphone or other gadgets? What can you do? Like what I'm doing now, I have a headset. I can see that my headset is working very well. I have a microphone. But what if I don't have a microphone? How do I apply appropriate volume? You can make sure that you can practice with your voice by, again, being in the privacy of your bedroom and looking at yourself in the mirror. And yes, there are several exercises so that we can make sure that the volume of our voice is really appropriate for a particular audience. In other words, what I'm trying to say here is that if you have a class of about how large are your classes? If you have a class of about 20, for example, will all your 20 learners be able to hear you? If you have a class of 40, for example, like in most of our classes in the School of Basic Education in the Philippines, will they be able to hear you? Today, of course, because we're holding virtual classes in all levels, this may not really be a problem because we are looking at the screen, your learners are listening to you, they are not present in one setting. But what if we now go face to face? Will you be able to appropriately apply the proper volume? Okay, so that's how it should be, no? Okay, are we done? Not yet. I don't think so. Just a minute, huh? Let's see if I have some other examples. Okay, is that the that must be the last one already? Okay, but I'd like to in the few minutes that we have left, I'd like to make mention of certain examples that we can learn from, especially in the teaching profession. Not all teachers, of course, no, are comfortable speaking before a large audience, no? Whatever the age bracket may be, whether nursery, elementary, and so on, or even in the graduate program or in the graduate school, discourse is really one of the more challenging aspects in communication. The reason is there are some teachers who are better read. No, it's better to read them, who are better read than heard. The reason is they may not exactly be confident speaking before their learners, even if they have been teaching for quite some time. No, maybe they will say, I can maybe have a lecture for about 10 minutes. The rest of the time, I will ask my pupils or my students to do some seat work or to do some homework. But we cannot avoid this possibility because we really need to teach. Thus, to close our discussion and also to connect discourse to grammar, let's be conscious again of what we are saying through the words that we use, as well as properly say them, so that not only should we become good teachers, because something that we do not know, certainly we cannot share, but let's also become not only good teachers, huh, but also good and effective communicators. So with that, I think this is now my last slide. Yes, there you are. Here is a teacher that's constantly talking, and the learners are already falling asleep. This teacher is not exactly sensitive to his learners, because look at that. The learners are already falling asleep, but here he is. He just goes on and on. Even in a virtual setting, maybe I don't know if my students have fallen asleep or they're doing something else, because most of the time, or not really most of the time, but sometimes, no, there are certain students who do not share their webcam, so I cannot see them. And this is really the challenge in virtual classes or online classes. So my parting shot for all of us, because we are all teachers, we are all in the teaching profession, let's be sensitive to our learners. And because communication is also education, and education is communication, let's combine the best elements of both, educating our learners through proper and effective communication. So I think we may now be ready for some questions, or maybe you have things that you need, that you may want to share, not only with me, but perhaps with our fellow learners, as well as our colleagues in the teaching profession. Thank you very much for your time. We can now be open for questions.
Yes, we are now open for questions, or if you would like to ask for suggestions, or you would like to share something, please unmute your microphone and turn on your camera so we can see your beautiful and handsome faces.
Yeah, yes.
Do we
questions
have
or insights? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Can we have a question from Mr. Jander? Sir Jander? Or probably?
Sir. No question so far, naman.
No question. What about from Teacher Gina? Mm-hmm. What about from Teacher Charles?
Teacher Charles,
I've got no questions, sir.
No question. Yes. What about Teacher Jay? Teacher Jerry?
Hello, sir. No questions, sir, but I've learned a lot from our speaker tonight, because especially with giving this what we call the emotion, like for example, sometimes when I get angry with my students, I smirk then smile. I think it's good.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Sir Jay. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Hello, sir. I have a question about body language,
because
I'm not mistaken, not all body languages are the same in any different cultures. For example, in our country, we do this, or in India, we are eating, or offer some food. But somewhere else, maybe in France or whatever, somewhere new, this is a bad gesture.
It's a bad gesture, sir. Bad.
Yes.
Okay. So yeah.
My question is, how do we learn all of those gestures? Because we might be doing something that is offending to another student, but it's okay to other students.
Right. Yeah. Yes. Thank you very much, Sir JP. Where are you, sir? Where are you now? Are you in Vietnam?
I am in Thailand.
Ah, okay, in Thailand, yes. May I use as an example? Yes, these Asian countries where we are, no? The Philippines, okay? This is the TESOL Coach Master is now in Vietnam. You are in Thailand, sir. May I make as an example? I don't know if this is still being practiced in Vietnam, huh? But in Vietnam, for example, I'm talking about body language. Okay, in Vietnam, it's not courteous or polite to cross our legs, okay? Especially if your toe is pointing to a direction where people are worshiping. That is a no-no, no? That's a taboo. That's body language, Sir JP, no? In Thailand, let me see, I don't know what some of their customs would be, no? But there are other Asian countries. For example, I think in Laos, no? Let me see. In Laos, I am talking about this in the context of the English language. In Laos, if I'm not mistaken, if you tell a woman that she walks like an elephant, that is the highest compliment. But if you tell me that I walk like an elephant, I you are my student, I will give you a failing mark, Sir JP. Oh. So to answer your question, you have to learn the intricacies of the culture of a particular place. Now, if you have students who come from varied cultures, you have to learn what is the culture in Thailand, what is the culture in Vietnam, in Laos, or wherever, or even in European countries, what is their culture. Among Filipinos, for example, diba Filipinos are really very demonstrative individuals, right? We like to hug, we like to touch, we like to embrace and so on. But today that is now probably taken differently. It may mean harassment or something, no? So let's be sensitive, Sir JP, to the culture of our students, and we have to learn it, no? And let's not do it, especially if we're not really sure that this is something that they practice in their respective places. Difficult indeed, but I think Asian countries, something like share some similar body language. I hope I answered your question, Sir JP.
Yes, you have. I asked that question because I used to have a student. She is half Thai and then half French. And
French,
then I didn't know. So she looks like an American. So I was like doing this, and her facial expression changed. So that's how I found out that she's not American.
Okay. Was it a non-verbal communication, a gesture, Sir JP, that you used?
Like this.
The one that you had made as an example. Okay. Yes. I think there's another Asian country. Is it South Korea, where there, isn't it that in the Philippines, if we say come on, something like this, we say this way, no? Come on. But that's not good in Korea. Or something. It's like come hither, no? It's bad. It's not good. But it's acceptable for us, no? Filipinos. We say come here. We gesture, or we ask you to come over, or something like that. But in Korea, it does not speak very well of a woman, especially if she's the one doing this. Very interesting indeed, no? Gestures and nonverbal communication.
Salamat,
Sir JP. Thank you.
JP, again, let's go back to the culture, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so wherever we are teaching, again, we have to learn the culture and adjust.
Yes. Very difficult, really. Very difficult.
Indeed it is. Okay. Other questions from the group? Do we have some other questions? No more questions. All right. So again, let's try to put it this way. Let's bring with us the last statement of Dr. Hinault, like communicating into education. Communication and education are they are twins actually. Mm. Let's try to combine, okay, the elements of the both, okay, for us to become effective teacher and of course to become effective communicator. So that our virtual class tonight for this course for English language teacher. Thank you so much, Dr. Hinole.
Thank you, Salama. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, and we will be meeting again, okay, for another, you know, virtual classes or another webinar or sessions, probably in the next, you know, few weeks or probably for the next month. Again, good evening, and I hope you have learned something from tonight.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Thank you. 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 Good night. 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 Take care.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
Are you looking for an internationally recognized TESOL certification in order to work abroad, start a new career, or further your career? Then TESOL Coachmaster Inc. is the answer. At TESOL Coachmaster, we provide advanced, quick, friendly, and affordable TESOL course, which is legal to find your ESL/EFL or other English teaching job anywhere in the world. TESOL Coachmaster is awarded by different organizations, such as the 2019 World Class Philippines Award in the field of education, online TESOL certification, 2018 to 2019 Global Awards for Marketing and Business Excellence as Best Online TESOL Certification Provider, and the recent National Customers' Choice Annual Awards 2020 as the most